waktu selagi masih muda, kamu tuh mesti kayak fail fast, fail cheap, fail forward.
Inilah Endgame.
Halo teman-teman, hari ini kita kedatangan Kevin Chandra. Beliau adalah founder dari Type Dream. Ini adalah startup yang berbasis di Bay Area, California. Hey Kevin.
Hai Pak Gita.
Terima kasih bisa datang.
Siap Pak, siap.
Anda tuh agak-agak beda dari banyak orang Indonesia yang saya kenal dan ketahui. Anda datang dari Indonesia, besar di Surabaya, terus datang ke sini gak bisa berbahasa Inggris, gak tahu apa-apa, terus but you've done well. Gimana tuh ceritanya?
Terima kasih Pak, terima kasih. Ya jadi saya tuh dulu besar 18 tahun di Surabaya. Sekolahnya gak pernah ganti. Jadi dari TK, saya tuh di sekolah namanya waktu TK, apa ya, sampai SMA tuh namanya SMA Kristen Gloria 1. Jadi, tapi sekolahnya dari TK sampai gede selalu di Gloria. Jadi saya waktu di sana tuh lebih membaur ke gimana ya, kayak itu sekolah nasional, lebih ke arah kayak middle, mungkin low end of masyarakat gitu kan. Nah tapi saya tuh selalu jadi anak yang lumayan unik di sekolah. Jadi mama saya tuh anak orang kaya dulu. Jadi sempat mama saya juga sekolah di USC gitu.
Okay.
Jadi dari kecil saya tuh selalu di instill kalau pendidikan tuh penting, kamu nanti pasti keluar gitu kan ke
lebih
Amerika.
Lebih dari mama atau papa?
Lebih dari mama kalau okay. Saya. Papa dulu soalnya putus sekolah. Jadi mama yang lebih push. Pendidikan tuh penting banget, science, mathematics, terus bahasa Inggris tuh penting. Tapi ya gitu kan, saya di sekolah gak ada orang yang bisa diajak ngomong bahasa Inggris gitu kan. Jadi ya belepotan gitu. Sampai akhirnya waktu udah besaran dikit, sepupu-sepupu saya tuh banyak yang dari sini juga. Jadi mereka datang ke Surabaya gitu main, selalu ngelihat saya tuh kayak, wah ini anak gak bisa diajak ngomong gitu. Jadi tiap kali kalau main bareng itu saya selalu jadi kayak the odd one out gitu. Gak ada yang mau ajak main gitu. Terus ada cerita-cerita kayak, saya dulu kalau diajak main petak umpet gitu, biasanya saya akhirnya main sendiri gitu. Saya mereka benar-benar gak suka gitu main sama saya gitu kan. Gak bisa ngomong bahasa Inggris nih anak gitu. Kayak konotasi kayak anak kampung gitu lah.
Mereka tuh semuanya ngajak Anda dalam bahasa Inggris.
Iya, ngajaknya
di Surabaya.
Di Surabaya. Iya.
Wow, oke.
Okay. Jadi mereka emang lahir di sini, besar di sini gitu. Okay. Kalau pulang main sama saya tuh kayak keberatan gitu sebenarnya. Nah, okay. Jadi saya tuh growing up pelan-pelan gitu belajarnya. Harus dari kecil saya udah kayak kepingin banget kan main sama mereka gitu kan. Oh, mereka punya mainan keren-keren, mainan game komputer yang saya nggak punya semua gitu. Tapi untuk main sama mereka tuh saya mesti pelan-pelan belajar untuk berkomunikasi dengan bahasa Inggris gitu. Yang saya tuh gak ngerti ternyata tuh sepenting itu.
Ya.
Saya dulu cuman pingin main gitu.
Ya,
nah jadi saya tuh dari kecil udah ngelatih diri saya dengan nonton-nontonin video orang bahasa Inggris, belajar di depan kaca tiap pagi gitu kan. Terus dari SMP sampai SMA tuh saya setiap hari kayak religiously tuh nonton video-video keynotes-nya Steve Jobs. Kayak saya bisa ulangin kayak word by word dia bakal ngomong apa. Just so saya bisa jadi kayak storyteller yang baik gitu. Kalau ngomong sama sepupu-sepupu saya ini enak gitu kan. Bisa bermain gitu sih salah satu cerita saya.
Waktu lulus SMA keputusan ke USC-nya gimana tuh?
Sebenarnya saya tuh gak langsung ke USC nih Pak.
Okay.
Kalau sekolah nasional tuh kan emang agak berat ya. Kalau mau kuliah di Amerika kalau gak masuk IB system. Jadi saya tuh harus masuk community college dulu.
Okay.
Untuk saya tuh namanya Diablo Valley College. Di Bay Area juga, di Pleasant Hill.
Yeah.
Jadi saya harus ke sana dulu, 2 tahun. Terus nanti baru saya transfer ke USC. Ya awalnya gitu.
Okay. Terus mata pelajaran apa tuh udah diketahui gak waktu Anda berangkat ke Amerika atau baru ketahuan waktu Anda udah mulai di Diablo?
Untuk mau majorin apa ya? Sebenarnya saya sebelum berangkat udah tahu gitu.
Oke.
Okay. Apa? Jadi, computer science gitu.
Okay.
That was it for me.
Kenapa? Nah, karena suka atau karena emang kebetulan bagus?
Jadi gini, untuk saya tuh ceritanya, I think it's much deeper than that. Jadi saya dari kecil tuh suka banget sci-fi. I was a huge Star Wars fan. Saya belajar bahasa
Star
Inggris.
Wars, yeah. Bukan Star Trek.
Bukan Star Trek.
Saya lebih Star Trek soalnya.
Saya dari kecil Star Wars, tapi semakin dewasa saya semakin pindah ke Star Trek sekarang. Yeah. Lebih realistis, yeah. Lebih interesting.
Star Wars lebih gontok-gontokan.
Iya.
Yeah. Star Trek lebih exploratory.
Bener. Yeah. Saya sekarang udah ke Star Trek, tapi initially saya tuh belajar bahasa Inggris banyak dari Star Wars gitu. Terus saya tuh ngelihat kayak, wah ini space ini keren banget ya gitu. Kayak the technologies they use, the gadgetry gitu kan, the spaceships. Kayak saya suka banget gitu. Terus dari sana itu saya jadi tertarik sama kayak, pingin banget gitu bisa bikin pesawat gitu-gitu kan. Tapi ya ternyata itu kayak, it's a pretty tall order gitu. Susah banget itu mau sampai ke roket gitu. Wah di Indonesia gak ada gitu kan roket. Yaudahlah diturunin dikit gitu kan. Akhirnya saya waktu SD itu sukanya ikut kayak robotics competitions gitu. Ini mainan robot. Nah dari robot saya itu juga introduced to software kan. Programming. Oh kalau bikin robot tapi gak diprogram tuh kayak ya gak ada soulnya gitu. Mau diapain nih ini robot geraknya gimana. Mau disuruh execute task apa tuh gimana kalau gak ada programming. Nah dari sana saya kayak interested. Programming is pretty cool ya. Dan mungkin ini tuh salah satu yang paling mungkin dilakuin yang modalnya paling kecil gitu kan. Jadi dari all the way from Star Wars dialed down to programming. Sampai akhirnya saya tuh salah satu generasi yang inspired banget dari film-film kayak Social Network. Again, I saw Mark and his dorm room friends gitu kan. Kayak, kita bisa mengubah dunia tuh cuman pakai laptop sama teman-teman bareng gitu kan. Kayak ngerjain group project tapi yang pakai the whole world gitu.
Yeah.
Terus dari sana saya realize kalau you know what, dengan limited modal ini yang sedikit banget
tuh,
itu you can actually do something really great gitu. Terus saya dari sebelum nginjakan kaki di US, saya tuh udah kayak ngomong ke diri saya sendiri kayak I have to find like-minded friends yang mau bikin something together gitu.
Menarik. Terus gimana dari Diablo ke USC? Karena mama yang minta atau emang?
Enggak. Itu karena saya gak mampu dapat 4.0 gitu. GPA-nya. Jadi.
Bukan ukuran tuh.
Iya. Jadi sistem edukasi itu di US. Kalau kamu masuk community college. Sebenarnya buat orang-orang di Amerika sendiri itu kan. Either buat orang gak mampu. Atau kamu kurang gitu di SMA. Kayak akademiknya masih kurang nilainya. Yeah, yeah. Jadi kamu masuk community college. Atau opsi ketiga kamu international student. Yang harus adjust dengan kurikulum Amerika. Sure. Nah, jadi selama di sana itu, kalau udah masuk community college, kamu tuh udah limited optionnya. Kalau mau transfer ya, transfer ke universitas di Amerika, kamu gak bisa kayak masuk, mau masuk Stanford gitu, udah kayak near impossible. Yeah, yeah. Hampir gak ada orang yang bisa masuk.
Yeah.
Nah, jadi pilihannya itu, kamu either masuk sekolah negeri, kayak the University of California system, UC Berkeley, UCLA, UCSD, gitu-gitu. Atau kamu masuk sekolah private line yang gak tergolong Ivy League atau Stanford MIT level. Gitu kan. Jadi waktu saya di Diablo Valley College, it is mandatory for you to get a 4.0 in order untuk masuk computer science di Berkeley. That was the best option kan. yang kita bisa dapat.
Ini written atau unwritten?
Ini unwritten.
Peraturan, okay.
Unwritten. Tapi most people yang transfer kalau dibuka application-nya kayak even teman-teman saya yang transfer, co-founder saya yang juga dua masuk ke Berkeley Computer Science tuh harus 4.0. Perfect. No blemish gitu.
Oke. Okay.
Ya, jadi saya tuh one of the ones yang ya akademiknya enggak terlalu sejago itulah untuk bisa dapetin 4.0.
Yeah.
Saya tuh akhirnya kayak 3.8 berapa gitu, 8.9. Yeah. Yeah, but I missed the mark. Jadi gak bisa masuk sana, and the best option itu was USC gitu.
Yeah.
Akhirnya transfer ke sana gitu.
Sekolah bagus banget.
Yeah.
The Trojans,
exactly.
Terus CS, ngambil computer science.
Ngambil CS. Yeah.
Okay. Gimana tuh setelah lulus atau waktu lulus? Perjalanan hidup.
Perjalanan waktu di USC-nya sendiri itu berat ya Pak. Soalnya kalau transfer ke private university, itu banyak kredit yang gak transferable. Jadi saya itu terpaksa ngurang ngambil kelas computer science itu dari freshman. Jadi apapun yang saya ambil di Diablo Valley itu dianulir semua gitu. Unless kamu transfernya ke sekolah negeri kan, yang emang made for that. Yeah. Karena ada kuotanya dari community college ke University of California system. Itu transferable. Tapi kalau enggak, ya ulang semua. Nah jadi saya tuh setiap semester tuh harus kayak ngambil 4-5 kelas core.
Heavy.
Computer science, jadi
heavy itu.
Agak berat, terus saya, ya kurang enjoy gitu waktu di sekolahnya gara-gara terpaksa ngambil. Ya anehnya tuh saya terpaksa harus ngambil kelas freshman sama upper division at the same time gitu. Jadi kayak it's very, it's not a seamless experience gitu kan buat saya. Betul. Kayak, oh kumpulnya sama anak-anak freshman tapi at the same time sama seniors kayak ya, a bit weird lah. Gitu. Nah, tapi selama saya di sekolah itu saya selalu keep in touch sama teman-teman saya dari DVC ini, dari Diablo Valley. Ever since saya nginjakan kaki di sini kan udah langsung kayak, cari dong teman-teman yang anak-anak Indo lain mungkin yang mau bikin sesuatu bareng kan. Nah kita sebenarnya gak pernah stop dari DVC. Jadi even waktu kita transfer, teman-teman saya tuh ada yang dua ke Berkeley, satu ke UCLA, satu ke UCSD. Even waktu kita transfer tuh kita selalu nyempetin waktu kayak, okay, guys setiap kali kita ada liburan, kita harus kumpul, kita harus coba something gitu. Dan yang kita ngerti tuh dari sana tuh kayak, waktu selagi masih muda, kamu tuh mesti kayak fail fast, fail cheap, fail forward kan. Kayak dan ini tuh, kamu bikin project kalau gak jalan, yaudah tinggal dibuang aja code-nya gitu. It doesn't require a lot of capital, move on gitu kan. Nah, jadi kita nyoba itu terus, wah makan asam garamnya tuh banyak banget Pak. Kita kayak belajar, waktu sampai tuh kan gak ngerti this whole tech industry, dapat funding tuh gimana sih, investor di sini tuh siapa aja sih, kayak mau sampai ke mereka tuh gimana caranya gak tahu semua gitu. Nah terus akhirnya kita tuh pelan-pelan mulai outreach kayak ke venture capital di Indo. Ini waktu selagi masih sekolah ya.
Betul. Tingkat berapa?
Ini waktu sophomore kayak tahun kedua. Tahun
masih kedua di
masih di ini ya? Sih. Wow. Kita udah reach out. Terus ya belajar the hard way dari sana kalau ternyata di Asia Tenggara tuh credentials tuh matter banget gitu. Jadi banyak orang tuh yang even ngelihat kita Diablo Valley gitu. Mau ngomong aja udah males gitu kan. Aduh ini anak-anak apa sih gitu. Kan yang biasa dilihat, oh kalau kamu lulusan Ivy atau Stanford, MIT gitu. Baru ngobrol tuh kayak.
Gelar minded. Brand minded.
Jadi kita ngerti dari sana kayak selalu dipush sama all these investors. Oh coba mungkin kamu transfer dulu ke sekolah yang lebih bagus gitu kan. Abis sekolah, coba mungkin kamu cari pengalaman kerja dulu di Silicon Valley, di company-company yang besar gitu kan. Abis itu coba dulu kamu mungkin masuk ke accelerator kayak Y Combinator. Abis masuk ntar the goalpost keep shifting gitu. To the point dimana kita kayak oh ya there's already
makin
so much.
Makin cute aja ya.
Kita kayak udah gak bisa ngelakuin, gak bisa lanjutin terus gitu kan. At a certain point gitu.
Terus kapan startup pertama dibikin?
Startup pertama itu kayaknya kita 2015 semester, 2016 sorry, semester 2. Itu pertama kali kita nyoba. Kita tuh kayak in total kayak udah ngerjain 7 mungkin 8 different projects bareng. Tapi ya semuanya gagal. Nah tapi yang saya pikir tuh mungkin yang penting itu setiap kali kita gagal tuh kayak gagalnya tuh naik level gitu.
Gagal hikmahnya, belajar dari pengalaman.
Gagal pertama tuh cuman dibuang gitu. Gagal kedua tuh kayak, oh sekarang kita udah ngerti cara dapetin user gitu. Karena kalau kamu cuman bikin doang, ya orang gak dateng gitu. Kamu mesti ngerti cara marketing kayak back to the old traditional values gitu. Belajar jualan dong gitu. Jangan dibikin doang gitu. Sekarang kamu belajar jualan. Habis di sana belajar kayak, oh cara raise duit dari investor tuh gimana gitu. Ya kan, oh ternyata apapun yang kamu bikin itu gak gitu matter gitu, apalagi ada seed stage. Storytelling itu lebih matter, kayak credentials itu lebih matter gitu kan. As long as you can execute di sana, mungkin kamu dapat gitu kan. Nah terus dari akhirnya kita kayak sampai masuk ke Y Combinator, terus setiap kali gagal tuh kayak buahnya tuh selalu naik terus gitu, sampai akhirnya ya sekarang gitu kan.
Jadi type dream yang ketujuh?
Mungkin ke delapan deh, ke delapan.
Mungkin atau pasti.
Mungkin.
Saya dan yang berlima ini masih?
Masih solid berlima, bersama. Masih solid bersama.
Luar biasa.
The original cast.
Itu gak gampang loh, untuk memaintain kelekatan. Apalagi, mungkin yang saya mau tanya, apakah karena kegagalan yang begitu sering, yang bikin kalian lebih lekat satu sama lain?
Benar sih.
Biasanya kan kita mikir kesuksesan yang bikin kelekatan semakin meningkat.
Enggak sih, benar-benar yang Bapak bilang, kayak semakin sering gagal bareng, itu kayak udah, so apa ya, udah kebiasaan banget dengan kegagalan sampai it just doesn't matter gitu. Yang kita lakuin kayak move forward aja gitu, coba lagi yang lain gitu. Jangan diulangin, udah belajar kan, it's exciting gitu. Seneng udah belajar, lanjutin lagi gitu, coba cari yang lain. Tapi lebih dari sana tuh mungkin juga kita tuh ketemu di waktu yang masih pas kan. Waktu masih lagi idealis-idealisnya, anak dari Indonesia datang ke Amerika, gak ngerti apa-apa gitu, terus udah bareng gitu. Jadi kayak cerita hidupnya tuh benar-benar align, bigger goalnya tuh udah align, jadi nothing else itu matters that much. And kita tuh belajar kayak along the way untuk tolerate a lot of the things lah. Yang, cause bikin sebuah perusahaan bareng, especially 5 orang ini kan Pak. Ini tuh kayak, kita tuh udah bareng, ini lebih lama dari yang the average marriage in the US kan. Jadi udah kayak berlima nih udah kayak partner gitu, udah kayak married to each other. Kita udah ngerti quirkiness-nya setiap orang, kayak keanehan-keanehannya apa, tendencies-nya, marahnya tuh kapan, malesnya tuh kapan, kayak udah belajar.
Udah gak perlu AI lagi untuk prediksi
bener.
Perilaku satu sama lain ya.
Bener, iya. Ya kita udah bener-bener ngerti personality-nya lah, each of the co-founders sampai bisa push each other.
Menurut Anda tuh bakal seterusnya gak sih? Kemitraan ini atau pertemanan ini, atau mungkin ini gak akan selamanya mengingat mungkin opportunities-nya juga mungkin akan berbeda di kemudian hari.
Kalau
atau challenges-nya lebih beda.
Menurut saya sih pertemanannya pasti a lifetime sih. Karena untuk cari orang lain yang pernah ngelewatin kayak begini bareng itu jarang banget kan, apalagi dari Indonesia. Tapi mungkin kalau sisi opportunities agak naif ya kalau saya bilang kita bakal selamanya bareng gitu. Selalu ada kemungkinan kayak oh mau pursue beberapa hal yang berbeda gitu. Later.
Ini lebih Beatles lah ya, bukan Kus Plus. Kalau Beatles kan ya mungkin pecahnya tapi sangat bisa dipahami lah satu sama lain.
Benar. Ya, tapi pertemanannya lifetime sih Pak menurut saya.
Terus cerita mengenai Type Dream.
Jadi Type Dream ini kayak tadi saya bilang kan mungkin ke-7, ke-8. Nah, basically ini tuh pembelajaran dari produk yang kita bikin sebelumnya. Mungkin saya explain-nya in English better ya, Pak. Jadi, so when we made Type Dream, it was actually because of the learnings of our previous product. It's called Cotter. It's a passwordless authentication platform that helps companies send OTPs, email magic links and all that. And we were trying to move down market. Okay, let's try to go somewhere that's easier. Maybe like something like prosumers, right? Still above consumers, because consumers don't really need that. So prosumers are people who don't know how to code, but they have a business. And they usually use website builders and no-code tools to run their business. And they need these authentication platforms to sign in their users, authenticate the transactions and all that. So we did that. And so we built a lot of different plugins for website builders out there, like Wix, Squarespace, Shopify, you name it, Webflow. And we had like a lot of requests coming in for people wanting authentication on Notion, which is actually a note-taking app. So that piqued our interest. What are you doing with a note-taking app that you need authentication for?
How did you break into the Y-com mold?
The Y-com mold is like, it's
not easy, right?
It's not easy. Like they always publish this acceptance rates of like below 1%, below 2%, sorry. And they always call themselves, like people call them on the internet, like the Harvard of startup accelerators, right? The people that get in there are like the founders of Airbnb, Stripe, Reddit, Instacart, DoorDash, Coinbase, all that cool companies. And for us, it was just, honestly, we just applied.
Guts.
Yeah, we just, it's not normal for Indonesians to do that, especially like Indonesian students here in the US to just try to apply to YC. Like they already have this misconception of like, we can't compete against these people. And so when we applied, we didn't even
think about these people being from maybe India, China, or the rest?
Mainly the US first.
Okay.
The US first. Wow. And then the Chinese and the Indians, yeah, wow. Which predominantly dominates the
tech industry. Well, they set the standards, right?
Yeah, they have. They really have. Yeah. And so for us, it was more like, oh, you know what? If we want to do this, since we can't raise from any investors at all, nobody believes in us, might as well take a shot, you know? It's just an application, guys. Like, it takes 30 minutes to fill in. And if they notify you that you get an interview, it's just 10 minutes away from getting funded. And we had no other option. Nobody's willing to fund us. And mind you, we were on a student visa. So if you're not working for a company, if you just quit your jobs, you have, I think, about 60 days before you get deported out of the country.
Yeah. Clock's ticking.
Yeah. So we were like, guys, we really want to do this. So we need somebody to fund us so that we can really work on this, like, seriously, right? So we just applied. It took us about, I think, 30 minutes to apply, recorded a video telling them, like, oh, why we want to do what we're doing, explaining to them the dynamics between the founders, like how we were with friends. And we waited, I think, about maybe almost a month after submitting the application to getting an email saying that, hey, you guys got an interview. And when we got that email, we were like, whoa. All right. At the time, there wasn't even 10 Indonesian founded companies at YC. I think we were number 9 or something.
Okay.
We got the interview and we practiced, you know, for the interview, like, religiously. Every day from the moment we wake up, the moment we sleep. It's actually not good advice. We were supposed to keep running the company, like, whatever we're doing. But we just thought, like, we really can't fail this, guys. Because if we fail this, then it's probably day jobs for us, right?
Yeah, we have to go it's do pretty existential. Yeah,
we got to do something else. Like, life moves on. So we practice it religiously. And then we even know the details of, like, how the YC interview works. It's usually only 10 minutes. You're faced with 3 group partners. And then they'll ask you rapid fire questions. There's a template for this. Like, if you Google it, there's, like, a somebody made a Quizlet, something like that for YC interviews. Just rapid fire questions. They're like, it seems to be like really hard questions that they ask, but they're not really. Like, after going through it, the common theme is just asking you about, so what's your business? What have you done? What are some of the learnings that you've learned that you can teach me? Hopefully, from this conversation, you walk out the door, I learn something new from you. And then the other theme is just about, so tell me why you, this team, right? Why are you the right people to do this? And if whether we want to work with you.
That sounds like a very common.
Very common.
Question.
But, yeah,
that anybody else would have asked.
Exactly. But at the time, we just thought it was like, oh, it's very hard because the way that they phrase these questions are very specific, right? Because they understand a lot of different industries and they usually pair you with a partner that understands your domain really well.
Wow.
So for us at the time, we were trying to bring US stocks back home from the US to Indo and other alternate investments, hopefully. We were paired with this one partner called Gustav. He's like somewhat the head of like for Southeast Asia. He interviews a lot of the Southeast Asian founders and companies. And he just knew directly where to strike. So our conversation wasn't even 10 minutes. It was a lot less than that. Because he read it. He's like, yeah, I know the landscape. I've prepared all the questions. So I'll just ask you straight on. All right, you're trying to do fintech. Regulations is, you know, pretty hard. All the licenses for you to get is hard. And yeah, I just want to know why your team is the one to get all those things. Like, to move in a regulated industry is not as easy as like just pure tech. You can just push code.
Sure.
Like every code, every new feature has to be evaluated by the regulators, the financial authority, whether you can do this product or that product, whether it requires a new license or not. So we just struck it on. And we were like, yeah, we just answered to our best. Right. We were in the process of going through at the time was like OJK sandbox, the local regulators. We just showed proof that, you know, it's ongoing. The conversation's ongoing. Yeah. And they liked that, knowing that we were still here, but, you know, we just kept on trying our best. And I think the thing that they value most, that YC has taught us once we're accepted, is that it's really not about the idea that you're working on, because ideas change. So their philosophy in investing is they invest in the people and the team instead of the idea. Like, the idea can be shaky,
yeah,
but as long as the founding team's foundation is really strong, if they see that you've been working together for a very long time, grind it through, you know, all the hardships together, that's the company that will succeed.
You've got what it takes to execute the idea.
Exactly. Yeah. So the market can always change, but the team has to be really solid. So yeah, I think all in all, we just applied. They really liked the team. And then we got in.
Wow.
And yeah.
And how long has the relationship been?
With YCOM. We got in, I think it was in late 2019, and we began the program, I think it was in early 2020. So it's been about 3 years, roughly.
Did you ever meet with Sam Altman?
Yes.
How was he like?
He's an unstoppable force of nature. I think you don't need to take my word for it. You can watch all the different videos on like how other YC partners think about him. Even the founder of YC himself, Paul Graham, said that if you know any founder from YC can really make it, it's got to be this guy. He's like relentless. This guy, he's something else. He's like a being from a different planet.
I want to use this as a way to segue or pivot to AI.
Sure. Right?
I mean, you strike me as somebody who understands AI.
Sure.
Tell us what your view is.
Yeah, for sure.
Of AI.
So I think
first broadly, then we can peel the onion a little bit more.
For sure. So I think talking about AI, right? For me, I'm not an expert in it, but I play around with it.
You sound like you know a lot about it after talking to you a few times.
Me and my co-founders, we sort of hack things together to try to find like what are the end user applications. So what's possible, right? And the way that I view it right now, a lot of people view AI as something that's like, what product can I make out of this? Like, it's the old internet days. Like, I'm trying to do a sell dogfood.com type of thing. Like, right. Like, it's a product. But the way that I personally view AI, it's not really just about a product. If you want to actually develop something that is related to AI, you got to think about it as a power up, like in a game, right? If you were to be a superhero, like what superpowers would you give yourself? So for example, ChatGPT, right? Something that is really popular amongst a lot of people worldwide. When they launched this new thing called ChatGPT plugins, the ability for ChatGPT to actually use and access your applications, that was mind-boggling to a lot of people.
Yeah.
But what really stuck with me was that ChatGPT is able to use more than one application at a time in parallel. So that is a superpower that humans can never have.
Yeah.
Right? Use your phone, your computer, you can't use more than one app at a time. You got to look at one thing and just, you know, manipulate the bits in that particular software. But this thing can use more than, you know, it can even use 10, 100. It doesn't matter. It's just a compute power thing, right? So right now, what I'm seeing in the market is that people are developing a lot of power-ups that enhances human productivity, right? So imagine if it can use 10 different apps together. Imagine if you ask it to do things like, can you read 10 books at the same time then?
Sure, can.
Can you watch 10 different videos at the same time, listen to 10 different podcasts at the same time, and be able to extract all the learnings from it? So it's like a technology that enhances your productivity to levels that has never been seen before.
Yeah.
And I think it is also one of the first time that humanity has invented something that can also have judgment, that you trust its judgment. It's not there yet, but it's getting there.
Yeah.
Like for certain tasks, you'll trust it more than a human.
Right.
So usually we've always been creating tools to, you know, the human judgment aspect has never been touched. Like you'll always need humans, but this is the first time ever in which you're like, hey, you know what? Actually, if my car, if I drive a Tesla and it says, you know, the tires are going to blow up in a little bit, I'll stop the car, right? If I'm flying a plane and they say that the engine is going to have some problems, I'll land the plane. Like, yeah, you trust the machine more than the human. And it's becoming more and more prevalent in, like, you know, the healthcare industry, right, and a lot of other things as well. So yeah, I think the way I view AI all in all is like, it's a superpower that you're giving humans to do the grunt work of a lot of jobs.
But what could go wrong?
What could go wrong is that the development of AI is so closed. Like, even OpenAI, the name itself is not, it's not really open, you see.
Yeah, it's closed source.
It's closed source. And
but it was open source.
It was, yeah. Exactly. But they changed.
And now it's for profit.
Yeah, it's for profit as well.
Should have been non-profit.
Exactly. So it's a black box, right? You don't really know what's going on inside. You don't know what data is trained on. And it's close into really big companies. So right now, if you want to develop fundamental AI models, you want to improve upon it, you want to develop like new cooler models, it's actually a capital and resource problem. It's no longer about the technology. Like, they've solved that aspect for this particular large language models. And whoever has the biggest compute power and the most money to train these AI models, because to train them, it costs a lot of money. It depends on the amount of parameters and the amount of data that you train it on. It could be something as simple as, you know, as cheap as like $100,000 one run, or it could be something as high as, I think OpenAI is like something north of more than $5 million just to train it, right? And for you to be able to train with that kind of, you know, capital costs, it's not for everyone. Because it is so closed source and it is concentrated in these, you know, big companies with a lot of resource, a lot of people whose industries are affected, whose jobs are going to be affected, doesn't really have any say in it.
Unfortunately.
Right? Yeah. And I hope that they're trying their best to be more inclusive.
Yeah.
When they train, and so they do this thing called RLHF, which is reinforced learning from human feedback. They'll include these people, right? That are beyond.
You believe that?
I hope so. I want to believe that.
I mean, a couple of observations, right? Yeah. The fact that he changed it from open source to closed source,
yeah,
non-profit to for-profit,
yeah,
is that a manifestation of his personality or his inability to manage the bigger stakeholders?
Yeah, I think I wouldn't want to speculate on this, but I'll repeat what Sam said. Right? Yeah. He explained it, like why OpenAI became a for-profit organization. And the reason is because they required capital and they couldn't raise enough to eventually reach their goal of building AGI, which is artificial general intelligence. It requires a lot of money and they can only get those kind of money from really big corporations like, right, Microsoft, yeah, right? In which doesn't really invest for charity. They want to get something out of it.
Right.
Exclusive rights to the model, the, yeah, weights and the training data and the consumer products and all that before any other company can. So he had to switch to raise the capital in order.
But he could have stuck on, right? With somebody like Elon Musk, who could have.
He could have.
Supplied him with the necessary capital.
He could have, but
as to maintain it, you know, yeah, closed source and nonprofit.
Yeah. Sam and Elon, they had a fallout even, yeah, before the deal with Microsoft.
Yeah.
I think it was before the for-profit thing. And because of that fallout, I think it's pretty hard to find another guy that's like Elon, that's willing, yeah, to risk a lot of capital to, yeah, to train something that...
I mean, he put in quite a lot of capital, $50 to $100, right? Yeah. Supposedly.
$50 to $100 million. Yeah, yeah. That's what,
yeah,
the word on the street is. Yeah.
but tell me this. I, yeah, mean, if it's... I get this effort.
Mm.
To try to attain AGI,
yeah, right,
which could happen in the next few years. Some people say 10 years, some people say sooner.
Yeah.
It really boils down to scalability, right? And you kind of alluded to this earlier. It's not so much a challenge in programming.
Mm.
It's a lot more in engineering, because when, yeah, you need to scale up,
yeah,
it becomes an engineering challenge.
Yeah.
Talk about that.
Yeah. So I think... right now, the challenge in the AI community, right? Like you said earlier, people are debating about when AGI is going to happen. Some say it's a few years, some say it's in a decade. Now, the thing is, humans haven't really discovered how the human brain works.
Right.
They don't even fully understand how these, you know, transformer architecture works. Like the way that they train it, they sort of set weights. They don't actually, you know, understand that if I do this particular thing, I'll get this outcome. It's more of experimentation on their end.
Right. Like
they know how to train it, but they don't know like what outcome will I get.
Yeah.
Even when they train it, if you check out the latest research paper from OpenAI and Microsoft, they were surprised at some of the capabilities that it was able to do, like few-shot problem solving. Right? Never seen the problem before, but given a bit of context, it can solve it. And now they're working on like maybe zero-shot problem solving, in which I don't need any background at all. You give me a problem, I'll solve it. So the problem is that nobody actually knows what we're dealing with, what we're playing around with. They're just by luck, right? They found this architecture that was actually used for language translation. By giving AI a language interface, like it got really big because you can actually talk to it now, right? Back then it was more like, oh, it is really good at this one task, but now it's kind of like generic enough so that you can talk to it and stuff, right? It's basically nobody actually knows what they're doing here, and they're just discovering new possibilities out of it. And this architecture is not broken to this point, in which they just kept increasing the parameters and the amount of data that they put into it, and it's still not breaking. It can still do more stuff. But people who say that AGI might take like longer are saying that, okay, these LLMs, you're seeing like crazy capabilities like in the short term, but maybe in the next few years, it'll plateau. That's all that it can do. Mm. It is nowhere near AGI. It doesn't have vision. It doesn't have like a lot of things that say a human has as input. It just has text, right? So probably not be scalable. Like maybe AGI is like a multimodal interface for AI, in which it can see, it can hear, it can feel, it can read. So yeah, a lot of mixed and different things.
My concern is, and I've had a separate discussion on this, is that, you know, OpenAI or LLM has gone through this phase of hallucinations, right?
Yeah.
And it's upon us to make sure that, you know, AI will hallucinate in a good way, right? So the feedback or the feedback loop, you know, ought to be done in a very robustly judicious manner.
Yeah.
So that it leads us or leads humanity to a good place as opposed to a not so good place.
Yeah.
Right? Because, you know, this is hallucinating. This is going to continue hallucinating. We just got to make sure that the hallucinations going forward are spurred by some sort of hypnosis that's done by us that will lead us to a good place. There is a risk, though, that the hypnosis is not being done in a good way.
For sure.
To the extent it's not done in a good way, then I think we might end up in a soup, right?
Yeah.
And the other observation that I've made is that, you know, much of the discourse is propagated, led and managed by the technologist with very little, if not no involvement of the other disciplines. And at the rate that this is not as multidisciplinary as it should be, I think that exposes us to a greater risk.
I believe the same thing. That's why, from my point of view, I really do wish when they develop these technologies moving forward that they'll be more inclusive, that they'll have people from multiple different disciplines to participate in the development, participate in the training and the reinforced learning by human feedback, which is not just focused on you know, a couple of Silicon Valley technologists in an office. Or computer scientists in general. Like, you got to include.
Especially, you know, it just kind of seems intuitively that it's going to get further elitized. Because who's going to be able to engineer this thing?
Yeah.
More extensively is the guy that has more money.
Yeah.
And the guy that has more money, I think, will be vested in making a lot more money for himself, herself, or themselves.
I agree.
Right?
Yeah.
I just kind of intuitively think that this will take us to a place where, sort of like what the internet has done. Mm. The internet was supposed to flatten the world, but it, I think, kind of deflattened the world because it hasn't really democratized ideas.
Mm.
It's democratized information.
Yeah.
I mean, we've seen how inequalities have gotten bigger, right? Yeah. In most parts of the world.
Yeah.
Developed and developing. I think AI is the next level of the unequalizer, potentially. So my question is, how do we mitigate this risk or potential risk?
I think from my end, it's just to, I guess, support more of the open source communities.
There you go.
Open source developments, yeah, like they are right now. And I hope companies like OpenAI, like all these closed source developments, will be made open so that anyone can participate.
Yeah.
Anyone can, you know, modify the models and not work with a black box. It's not an API hit. I don't know what it does. It just spits out things that, you know, works for me, right? They got to really see the insides of it. And I think at the moment, I think companies like Stability AI is doing like really good open source work. And if you check out a lot of the different models from Hugging Face, which is like the GitHub repository for AI models that you can run on the cloud as well. The open source community are getting better and better at it. And what's impressed me the most is that some of the models that they've built is with less training data, less parameters, but it's the performance is, you know, getting there to equaling what OpenAI is doing. But yeah, I hope for the future, it's more of these open source models gaining traction rather than those of the closed source ones. But I do understand why it's necessary for like these closed source models to be developed, because, you know, with a lot of compute power resources and you have all the best talent in the world, maybe for specific tasks, right? You can do it better if it's closed source. But yeah, I just hope that, you know, they're good people as well. they don't, you know, develop it in a certain way that, you know,
fingers crossed.
Yeah,
but it's risk. Explain this.
Yeah.
Again, I guess you've explained this to me earlier. How the future is going to be, you know, more with using our two thumbs as opposed to audio for, you know, the usage of LLM going forward.
So I don't think the future is going to be two thumbs.
Okay.
Right. I do think that. So the history is like, now we're computing at the speed of our fingers. Right?
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if you're on a computer, it's typing on a keyboard. If you're on a phone, it's your thumbs.
Right.
Right. I think the future would be computing.
Well, I type with two thumbs. So. No, I'm just kidding. I'll type right.
Yeah. So I think the future would be whatever is convenient, right? Whatever is the best way for you to communicate that idea. It could be through voice. If it has to be through text, it will be through text. If it's through touch, then it might be through touch.
Which is more likely to be the case?
I think the most... So I have this point of view, right? One of my friends who's not a technologist, he's actually a musician. So he told me that whatever technology is trying to do in the music industry is that it's trying to replicate whatever is in the real world. Mm. It's just trying to be more and more real and less synthetic.
Yeah.
So I think in the future, with the advent of LLMs, I do believe that typing with your fingers and your thumbs, it's kind of limiting to certain tasks. It could be through voice. Maybe that's, you know, the most natural way that humans converse with each other, deliver ideas.
Yeah.
You know? It could be through that. And today, that technology already exists. So OpenAI has this thing called Whisper. There's a bunch of other open source models who can already capture audio, turn it into text flawlessly, even with the ums and buts. And a lot of different languages, I think almost all, it can be translated into any language. So yeah, I do believe that in certain tasks, it should be voice. In certain tasks, it should be text. Whatever is convenient, the fastest way to deliver the idea.
Well, there are people who claim that they can think better when their fingers are moving.
Yeah.
Then there are people who claim that they can think better when they're talking.
Yeah.
Right. So do you envision a future in the near where you see a massive dislocation of real jobs? I think one of the debates that I've had with some people is, will AI be able to write novels as good, if not better, than what J.K. Rowling would have done, or Stephen King would have done?
Got it. So those are two different questions. First, dislocation of jobs, right? I think we will see a lot of jobs getting replaced in the next few years. I do believe so, because there are a lot of like white collar workers now at the office whose jobs are just to punch in numbers, right? Which isn't really different from like decades ago. It's just through a different interface.
Right.
It's spreadsheets, documents, presentations, which are the things that most white collar people do.
Correct.
Right? That'll be easily replaced by AI. But what I do believe as well is that it'll create new kinds of jobs that didn't exist before. Right? Humanity has always adapted to the invention of technology.
Yeah.
Before electricity, after electricity, industrial revolution, before and after. We'll always find new things to work on. And what I find really pleasing about this AI development is that now as humans, we can actually work on the really important things like curing cancer, right? Space exploration, solving world hunger, something, that's not just trying to manipulate bits and pieces, creating, weird content on the internet just to make a quick buck. You can actually focus on the really important problems now. And then the second, you asked about, can AI write better novels, right, than J.K. Rowling or Stephen King? At the moment, it can't. It can't create something that humans haven't already created. At the moment, it's a really powerful assistant. It helps you clear out the grunt work. It makes, I think, a lot of people who are in the workforce, they can sort of, get promoted to a managerial level. You don't do the grunt work. Maybe entry-level jobs aren't about getting told what to do anymore. You got to be able to think for yourself. Like it could be in the next decade or so, every software engineer has to be a CTO level.
Mm.
You're thinking about architecture, right? About how to scale these systems instead of moving buttons, right? So I think at the moment, no. But there will come a time in, the next few years, next few decades, where they will be able to do that. I think what people are discussing right now is that within the decade, they could be co-authors in research papers, right, to that level.
I think sooner
than
a decade.
Yeah, that'll be really...
I know some writers were already talking about stuff like that. It's scary.
Yeah.
What about singers? What about actors?
Oof. See, this thing
singers,
about...
Singers, I think, would be easier than actors, right?
Yeah. So... Lately, there's been a lot of development in the media industry tools, like the AI tools for the media industry, right? There was this song released, I think, a couple of weeks back that was trending. It was like Drake and The Weeknd.
Yeah, I heard that.
That was...
Awesome.
I was mind blown. If I didn't know it was created by AI, it would have been easily a Spotify top 10. I would believe that that's something that Drake and The Weeknd made. So...
But maybe we got to do an Indonesian version of Drake.
Maybe, yeah. I've seen a lot of content around President Jokowi singing dangdut song, which is like pretty cool. Pretty funny as well. But yeah, I think to me, it just raises the bar, right, for people in the media industry. Right. Like if you're a movie director, you can't just keep milking franchises like what the maybe, this is my personal opinion, but maybe like the Fast and Furious series. Just keep milking that content or, you know, any other franchise that's like Transformers. Just keep milking the content. Same template, but different kind of storyline, but still the same thing overall. It raises the bar to which if you're a movie director, at least be at Christopher Nolan's level. Mm. You know, you can't make those kinds of things anymore.
Yeah.
But the good part about it is as well, what I see in these developments is that it's democratizing the creation of music and movies. Mm. It's not just Hollywood anymore. Anyone in the world, if you have a good enough camera, like a phone, you could edit it to be a late 2000s or early 2010s type of movie with CGI and all that.
Right.
From the web browser on your computer, which is really awesome. For me, the future of entertainment would be like very, very personalized. And I'm feeling this way. I want to hear this kind of song sang by this person.
You know, it's just kind of, it's scary in the sense that it's just going to make humanity more lonely.
Mm.
Right? You can artificialize connectivity with anything of superlative qualities. You know, that sort of like pulls you away from the real interaction with real people.
I hope it's the other way around, but I get...
I think there's a lot of positivities that AI is going to bring about, such as education. I mean, we can talk about our part of the world, Indonesia and Southeast Asia, right? I mean, I've been thinking, you know, there's less than 5 to 10% of the population of Southeast Asia that could speak English the way you do, right? Imagine if 50% of the population of Southeast Asia can speak English, can speak Mandarin, can speak Japanese, can speak whatever international languages that allow themselves to be able to internationalize. You know, that will just open up possibilities for the others to be like you, be able to fly over to LA, the Bay Area, and then coexist, you know?
Yeah.
There's a lot of people in Southeast Asia that have not gotten a good taste of the democratization of opportunities because of that simple lingual, you know, obstacle. And I think at the rate that, you know, we don't have that many teachers, that many great or good teachers, AI can be very helpful. I think it can accelerate process.
I do believe so. It is happening today. If you go to, I think websites like, I think it's character.ai, it's developed by, I believe it's one of the team members from Google's DeepMind who exited Google. There, you can choose like, learn a language. I think there's Chinese, Japanese, and all that. And if you want to learn a new language, right? For me, it's been about if you converse with actual people, it's the easiest way for you to pick up a language. And these tools, they do exactly that. Like you can talk to it about your day. It'll ask you questions like a normal human would, but in the language that you want to learn. So
will it correct you also?
Yes, it will.
Wow.
It would. Yeah. Wow. And there are some, I think it's like called speak.com that teaches English. It can even do it through audio. So it's like you're even talking to, you know, a non-existent friend that speaks English that helps you correct
like a Siri.
Like a Siri, yeah. But a lot better because, you know.
Wow.
It can fix your intonations, word choice, vocabulary. It is amazing what these tools can do, specifically for education, because I think growing up, right, for me, I've always had a problem when things get hard as a student.
Yeah.
I would kind of like want to run away from that thing. So I'm like, I'm not going to go through with it. And I've recently discovered that that's because when I was a kid, my mom pushed me a lot, especially in, you know, all these Asian kids go to Kumon, right? And when I was in kindergarten, I was doing multiplications and divisions, And it was kind of hard for me to comprehend. And then when they start to introduce me to algebra with all the letters, I got freaked out. And I'm always used to seeing that, you know, at Kumon you get this 100s with the red marker and the circle around it. And that was the first day that I didn't get it. And I didn't know that it would be such a profound moment for me growing up, that I would keep on running away from like really difficult subjects. And the reason why I tell you this story is because a lot of humans, they actually aren't dumb, but they give up when they learn in certain conditions and they don't have a teacher to guide them through that. So when I use these AI tools, like when they teach language or even, you know, mathematical concepts, scientific concepts, other subjects, they can identify like the moment where you're about to give up and give you that extra boost that you've always needed. When you get confused in class, you know, when you were a kid, you're like, I don't know how to do this and I don't know what to do, right? It identifies that exact moment and it gives you what you need.
Yeah.
And it speeds up the learning process by quite a lot. Yeah. And that's what I'm really impressed by these technologies when it's used the right way, especially for education.
I agree, totally. I just think that the low-hanging fruit that the Indonesians need to get over is that lingual proficiency. And I've seen with my own eyes, I've said this many times over, where at such time when a person overcomes that obstacle, lingual obstacle,
yeah,
he or she just feels very differently.
Yeah.
It just is an injection of confidence that translates into this person's becoming, you know, someone to the power of.
I agree.
Right?
Yeah.
And that, I think, is what we need.
Exactly.
Just imagine if 100 million Indonesians speak an international language.
That's an economic unlock.
That's game-changing, man. And I think AI can accelerate this.
Yeah.
You know, one would think that it's probably going to take us a decade to get there.
I hope not.
I hope not too. And speak your Javanese, speak your Bahasa, speak your Sundanese, speak your whatever. But speak an international language, because we need to become a more relevant part of the international community. Because we're big.
For sure.
We're not a small potato. You know,
I've experienced it firsthand, right? From my end, when I actually raised, when I actually raised from investors here, one of my investors asked me, like, "So you're from Indonesia, right? Yeah. How come I rarely meet your people? Like, you're the first Indonesian that I've invested in, and I've invested in a lot of companies like Pinterest, Coinbase, you know, big international." A lot of immigrant founders as well. But why? Where's Indonesia? Like,
yeah.
Where are your people?
Yeah.
And I couldn't answer that. And he kept, you know, asking me questions, wanting to understand more about the background. He's like, okay, let's not talk about tech. Maybe it's too high end. It's too elitist. How come in America, right, I can't fly to your country, like one direct flight away. But I can fly in a lot of countries in Southeast Asia, like Singapore, Malaysia, right, Vietnam, or even in South Asia, India.
There's a direct flight to Hanoi from San Francisco.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And he kept asking me even further questions, like, in any corner in California, like in the big cities, right, New York, LA, SF, I could find Vietnamese food, Korean, Japanese,
yeah,
even here, Singaporean food now. Right.
Oh yeah, you got Kopitiam.
Yeah, killing me.
Killing me.
How do I find your food? It's normal in my diet to eat pad thai and pad siew.
Yeah. Like,
they even can call it by the Thai name of these dishes, and asking me about things like culture, where are they? And I just couldn't answer any of them. And I felt like, you know, an anomaly. And he told me that, so this guy is Indian, right? The way that he made it is through the other Indian immigrants before him who came to the US, who paved the way for him.
Right.
And it's always better for the next generation.
Yeah.
And he told me this one really profound statement that whatever that I do, even if you failed, but you guide the next generation, you're not really a failure. You become their stepping stone for Absolutely. A better future for the next generations. And he told me that it should be part of your mission, you know, to bring more of these Indonesians
yeah.
to learn here and explore and make it here, right? And become stories like how, you know, the Indians and Chinese back home can derive from their role models.
Yeah.
All the CEOs of these tech companies are Indians these days.
Man, you know, there's this, you know, public secret that 30% of the new ideas in Silicon Valley are coming out of Indians.
Yeah.
And there's a staggering statistic about the H-1B visas. 75% of H-1B visas are given out to Indians every year.
Yeah.
The Chinese only make up 10%. The Koreans only 2 to 3%. The Indonesians... 0.whatever percent. and it's somewhat empirically correlated with the representation of each country in all the campuses. But if you take a look at the mainland Chinese, there are 400 to 450,000 all across campuses. The Indians are about 200,000, disproportionately smaller than the mainland Chinese, but they disproportionately got much more of the percentage of the H-1B visas. I think something to think about.
Definitely.
You know. Hey, you've basically proven to yourself, to your family, and to the world that you grew up in a place where you spoke Javanese.
Yeah.
You spoke Bahasa.
Yes.
You may speak Mandarin. You speak English. You survived in one of the most competitive tech environments in the world.
Yeah.
Right? And I think you could be an inspiration to a lot of people. I want to ask this final question. What do you think you would have done differently all along?
I'm that type of person that doesn't regret anything. And I believe that I learned things at the right time that I could take it. But I think if I could do it earlier, I would have learned languages earlier, honestly. That is...
Dude, you're doing all right.
I mean, I would... Being fluent is one thing. Being articulate is another.
Dude, you're doing all right.
I hope so. So I think if I could learn from, you know, maybe if I was like in kindergarten to be able to speak all the international languages, that is not just limited to... I'm only limited to, I guess, English that I can speak this way, as well as Bahasa, maybe. But I wouldn't limit myself to just those two languages. Yeah. Why not speak Chinese? Why not speak Japanese? And learn from all these, from all these developed countries. And, you know, I'll be able to grow a lot faster and learn a lot of mistakes faster, because one of the greatest unlocks, right, by learning English at a young age is that, want it or not, the fact of the matter is that a lot of research, a lot of books are written in that language. And even content on the internet are
spoken. The way people learn is mostly in English.
Yeah.
All the books.
Exactly.
The way people undertake economic activities, it's mostly done in English.
Yes.
It's not a statement of race or nationality or geopolitical, you know, interest, but it's just the fact.
Yes.
So if you want to undertake greater degree of economic activities, if you want to learn more, I think you got to learn English.
Yes.
And now increasingly Mandarin and some of the other European languages, I think it would be cool too.
Yeah.
To learn. So
I think number one, it's definitely language. It unlocks, you know, you learning from other people's mistakes.
Yeah.
I got to YC
today. I forgot
today.
Japanese. Yeah. That's also another important part.
Yeah. I got to YC today because I watched their videos growing up as well. Yeah. Even though I didn't follow it as religiously as Steve Jobs is. But if I weren't able to speak English, I wouldn't be able to understand like all these new technological developments and whatnot. And I think the second would be, I would try to be more confident.
Yeah.
Because I think the culture is that growing up from, I think this is not idiosyncratic to Indonesia, right? I think most Asians are, we're humble by default.
Right? Yeah.
We don't want to speak our minds. We tend to shy away from conversation. Just put in our heads, talk behind our backs. But I think what I learned from people
you
here.
You know, when they do that, the Indians take advantage of the moment. I tell that to my Indian friends.
I see. Yeah. So I think for me, confidence and, you know, just dare to make mistakes.
Mm.
It's not to be ashamed of. Because growing up, I think at school, I was always taught that, you know, if you get a bad grade, it's kind of shameful. But it's not.
Yeah.
It's sometimes it's part of learning.
Isn't it an irony that you actually would have attained more confidence out of your failures as opposed to successes?
It is, yeah.
Right?
Didn't realize that, but yeah. Dude. When you're so comfortable, you know, if you've failed 1,000 ways, you just don't know how else to fail because you've done it all and subconsciously you're being guided to the right direction and yeah, you become more confident. Like I've done that. I've made that mistake and I've learned from that and I'm not going to repeat that again.
Yeah.
So yeah, just language and dare to do more things. Yeah. What I've learned now is that being me at this very moment, like being surrounded by these kind of people, I feel like nothing's impossible.
Yeah.
Right. If I ever want to do space exploration one day, you know, be like Elon, why not?
Yeah.
You know, it's not impossible to have an Indonesian flag flying a rocket that goes up and down.
Yeah.
Delivers goods that way. Or cure cancer.
Yeah.
Like you've interviewed tons of amazing Indonesians who's done that, who has never been highlighted.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Like keep that fire alive and burning.
For sure.
I wanna be there to see it.
For sure.
Thank you. Makasih banyak, Kevin.
Makasih, Pak. It was a good conversation.
Yes. Teman-teman, itulah Kevin Chandra dari Type Dream. Terima kasih.
Inilah Endgame.
This guy could have gotten burned.
Zero shot problem solving, which I don't need any background at all. You give me